Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. I like it. I feel like this is the rowdiest bunch we've had. It's maybe it has something to do with the fact that it's all about beer right now, right? Shifting from wine to beer. So I'm Amanda Haas, and I'm a Whole Foods Market Culinary Ambassador, and I'm so happy to be here with you. I would say all weekend, but this is the last demo of the weekend, so very happy to kick this off. First, I would like to introduce Doug Tarola, who's the filmmaker, and we're going to take a quick look at your trailer, Doug, before we get cooking.
Beer is the most noble beverage ever conceived of by man.
I love beer. I love to drink beer.
Beer's a way of life.
I like the way it smells. I like the way it looks. I like the way it tastes. I like the way it makes me feel.
After first sip, they recognize that this is gift from God.
In the last year, there have been 4 new breweries opening every business day.
It's growing exponentially right now, and I don't think that's going to stop anytime soon.
People don't like to talk about it, but there's a bubble, you know, and bubbles burst.
All right.
There's a lot of precision that you can put into it if you want to. Me, being type A, I want to put it all in there.
Home brewers are cooks. Brewmasters are chefs. This is not a game. There's something to this.
I figured out I didn't want to be a lawyer anymore.
The long-term focus is to make a functioning, operating brewery.
For the people who are excited about beer, want to make beer as a career, you know, maybe we should have a sommelier for beer. And it's actually hard to pass the exam.
Being, I think, probably a naturally competitive person, I said, I want to go for master level. So, we'll see.
The Great American Beer Festival is kind of like the Super Bowl in the brewing industry.
If someone is willing to call themselves a brewmaster, they better come correct and prove it.
I'm at 65 freaking pages. Who writes a 65-page business plan?
This is my happiness, and I really think this is where I see craft beer going in the future.
If you can't put that beer out tasting essentially the same every time, that doesn't mean you're a craft brewer. It means you can't brew.
Number 6 was hard. Is it Dortmunder?
Just a little. Yeah, you guys fans? Every step I take, every brewer I discuss, every beer I sniff puts me one step further. This is it.
I love it. I love it. Well, I think it's a really fun way to bring your film to life, Doug, to have food and beer here to bring together. So I would love to introduce Chef Bob Hurley to you all as well. Please come on out, Bob. Hello. He's got his beer in hand. I knew that this was going to be a fun way to end the day,
this
right?
This is great. The last one, right?
Oh, exactly. So we are so lucky to have him here today. If you're local, you know that he had Hurley's in Yountville for 16 years. Yes. And it's taking 1 year, you told me, 1 year without commitments. But here he is
except
today.
For this one. That's right.
Exactly.
So we're
so lucky to have you today. And then in conjunction with that, we're so lucky to have your friend Don Barkley, a master brewer, here with us. And Josh Waldman, the brewmaster who has made the space dust that you're drinking from Elysian. So thank you both for being here.
Thank you very much.
To have this incredible combination of people. So, Chef, as we get into this story about beer and your love for it and pairing, I'm really curious about what you're going to make for us today.
Well, one thing about beer, as opposed to beer pairings, beer and food pairings, as opposed to wine and food pairings, it's a little easier. Wines can get really complex and have a lot going on. With beer, there's 3 or 4 things that you really have to think about in pairing it with the wine.
Right.
And it's just... beer as a beverage is a refreshing beverage.
Very.
And so that makes it right away, it just pairs with food pretty easily.
It's friendly.
You can and you can do spicy things, you can do sweet things, sour things, things that you would never, never want to, you know, pair with wine.
Right. So I can't wait to see. You've done something where I'm looking at even the spices, and you all have a sample out there already. We're doing kefta.
It's a Moroccan dish. The reason I chose that is because mostly the spices and the richness of the beef.
Wow.
And this particular beef, we'll talk about it later, I think. But this particular beef was raised on beer. So what you're eating right now.
It's a happy cow. Definitely a happy cow.
That's that. That's Don's territory.
We'll bring that full circle too. Not only is Don a master brewer, but he also raises the cattle and he feeds the grain to the cattle. And so they are literally happy, happy cows. So great. Well, let's get started with your recipe. What have we got?
So I'm going to start here, but I'm not familiar with this setup.
Help you. So which pan would you like first?
This monogram thing is incredible.
It's gorgeous. Like, it's induction.
It's beautiful, this induction.
It heats up so quickly, and you'll fall in love with it. So what would you like done first? Want that one turned on. Okay. Great. On medium. I think I can do that.
This one on medium as well.
Okay. And it's just like you can touch it with your finger.
I can do that?
Yeah. You just touch it.
Oh, that's incredible.
It's like magic, right?
This is beautiful.
And any others on too?
This one is on medium, right?
You got it.
Not this one.
No, not the middle one yet. We'll just do the two side ones on medium for you.
Okay,
great. We've got those preheating.
So I'm going to take the chicken stock.
Okay.
And just bring it to a boil. That's for later.
And this is, I'm guessing, maybe going with the couscous that you're serving with it.
Right, okay. And then we're going to saute some vegetables here. This is all about the couscous right now.
Got it. Oh, so the veggies are going to go in the couscous and not into the kefta.
No, we will put some veggies in the kefta, but first we're going to do the couscous because that takes a little longer.
Do you need the oil?
Yes, I do.
I'm very excited if
I
can help.
You can dump some oil in there.
Okay, you got it.
About
just
half
to coat?
That.
Okay.
About half that, and we'll see.
A little more?
A little bit more.
Yeah, you just want to coat the bottom of the pan.
Okay, that's good.
Great.
The whole idea here is we're getting the flavors of the vegetables and the spices.
Okay. Are you going to toast those spices
as well? To put it into the
well?
Couscous.
Got it.
Often couscouses are fairly, can be very plain.
Right.
But I like to jazz mine up, especially for this particular pairing.
Well, I know it's going to be delicious. And I'm really curious, as I was speaking to Doug a little bit and just getting to know everybody here. And when I asked Doug, why would you make this movie, as he's got a mouthful of food, I loved your answer. And when you're done trying the amazing kefta, I would love to hear, here's a mic for you. What made you want to do this film?
Well, obviously, so I could get a lot of free beer.
Yeah, it's not a bad profession.
I'd made a movie a few years ago called Hey Bartender, which is sort of about the cocktail renaissance. And I think when I was growing up, if someone was a bartender, you know, someone would go, oh, I guess it didn't work out for them. And the movie sort of showed that, exactly. So the movie sort of showed that people were making that sort of choice. And then a few years on, having become friends with a lot of bartenders, they were like, it's all about beer now. People just love beer. And I remember going to a restaurant and you'd get, you know, your wine menu in the beautiful leather sort of bound thing. And then about 10 years ago, you got your cocktail menu. And now you go to a restaurant and they're like, and here are great beers that we have on tap or that we
it's
have
about
on tap
time.
This week. And so it really started out sort of trying to understand that. And then it became about following a couple of characters as they're trying to make it in beer. One is, as the trailer, I think, shows us, one of the things we learned is that they have a psalm for beer, which was I couldn't even believe that.
Well, it looks like the level of education they need to get through it is very similar.
Right. So they have a thing called the Master Cicerone Program.
Wow.
When we started the film, only 11 people had ever passed it, and we follow one of the people trying to pass it.
That's
and then
so
another
cool.
guy who, you know, shows up his first day at a law firm in New York and goes, I hate being a lawyer and I want to brew beer. And so that's how we got into it.
And the film is showing right now, you were saying, right? It's
playing right now, but I came here because food, I love movies, but food and beer are good too.
You're living your dream.
Who's like a documentary fan? Anybody?
Yeah.
And who loves beer? There you have it.
So there you have it. We get it. We get your calling here.
Yeah.
So great. Thank you for sharing that. And, Chef, what are we doing? So your veggies are sautéed?
I just sweat these in olive oil, meaning you want to do it at a low temperature. You don't want any browning.
Okay.
And we've got carrots, leeks, and red pepper in there.
Gorgeous.
Now I'll add the spices. The spices come last.
All right.
You need to cook them a little bit to bloom. They call it blooming, to make the flavors come out.
Right.
Okay?
So what have we got? Cumin?
We've got cumin and cinnamon.
Great.
Cinnamon
I love those warm spices.
Cinnamon is one of those spices when you're eating Moroccan food that sometimes it's very subtle.
Right.
It adds an awful lot.
Oh, and it's so fragrant, just giving them that chance in the oil to bloom.
I'm going to need the rest of that oil.
Absolutely.
Here you go. I can see that now.
Okay, great.
Great, thank
you. Obviously, you've done this for a long time, so it's really easy for you to gauge what you're doing there.
Yeah, what's funny, and a lot of people don't understand, is as chefs, we cook by feel, by feel. And putting a recipe together sometimes is not that easy.
It's the worst when you have to measure.
Okay,
right?
A little mint in there.
Okay.
And then we're going to take this off
the heat. Gorgeous. I'll turn that one off for you.
Thank you.
Delightful. on this, it already knows actually that you took it off, so it shut it off for you. It's like they don't need us anymore. It's remarkable.
I'm going to add these vegetables so you can see that to the couscous.
Oh, gorgeous.
So that has the vegetables and the olive oil and the spices. And we're going to mix that so all the grains in the couscous are coated.
Okay. And what I love about couscous is that this cooks so quickly.
It does.
It's like a 5 minute.
And there's another couscous called Israeli couscous, which isn't couscous at
all. It's not.
It's a pasta.
It's more like a pasta.
So beware of that when you're dealing with couscous. Israeli couscous is different. It's very good, but it is different.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so we have all that covered there.
And it's going to go into the stock.
Coated in the oil. And now we have a boiling stock. We should.
Let's see. Well, the glory of all of this is that they've already had theirs, right? But it did. It knew to turn it off again when we had taken it off the heat.
Okay, off you go.
There we go.
So we put on the magic of boiling stock.
Okay. And do you need to cover it?
And we need to cover it. We should have a plastic here. They promised me one.
Or we put a towel or the top of the pan.
Well, okay. Let's pretend we have plastic.
We will.
And we just put plastic on there.
Do something.
Let's do that. Okay.
Ta-da.
And we'll put that there and you put it in a warm place.
Okay.
For about 10 minutes or so. Okay.
And it's just going to kind of hydrate.
It's
going to get all that liquid and the spice in there.
Yeah, it'd be very nice. All the flavors will melt.
Okay. Amazing.
Now we're going to do the kefta.
Kefta
is like a Moroccan meatball kind of thing, but we're putting it on a skewer.
And so, Don, this is where your beef comes in. Besides being, you shared with me, the most experienced master brewer in America.
The most experienced American craft brewer in the industry today.
The most experienced craft brewer in the American craft brewer in the industry
That's
today.
Right.
I love that.
Yeah.
All right.
Started in 1978 at the
Amazing.
New Albion Brewing Company, the very first craft brewery to open up in the United States.
That's.
And when that slid under the waters in 83, moved up to Mendocino County and started the Mendocino Brewing Company.
Oh, wow.
And that was the very first brew pub to open up in the United States in Hopland, California.
Hopland.
Producing Red Tail Ale and Eye of the Hawk and all
Which
those.
You loved.
Red Tail Ale. I knew good beer before I knew what good wine was.
And it was
about.
His.
And Red Tail Ale was on the top. So when I had the opportunity at Hurley's to do a beer dinner, and I found out it was Don, I was in awe. And I thought, this guy.
He's your rock star.
And then, and then he came along, and he's just this hippie guy.
He's just this hippie guy.
This hippie guy
who's making beer and raising cattle.
That is obsessed with beer.
We had such a good time.
Oh, that's so amazing.
We've done this before.
Yes, you have. Okay, so what are we going to add to the meat?
We've got the beef here. So we're going to add the cilantro.
Okay.
We're going to add a little bit of garlic. The onion,
chopped white onion, really finely chopped.
It all has to be very chopped.
I love this about Moroccan food is that I had the pleasure to go there and take cooking classes. And they're like, you silly Americans always braising and cooking everything beforehand. They put a lot of things in raw like this. And I love it.
Cumin, coriander.
More of that cumin.
Cinnamon, again.
Okay.
Those are all
These are going to go in
Moroccan
as well.
Spices. We have some cilantro here.
Ooh, delightful. So now I'm really curious, too, because I love the beer that we chose today. And Josh, who's here, we're lucky enough to have him here from Seattle, from Allegion, has made the space dust that you're trying. So, Josh, tell us a little bit about your beer.
Sure. Yeah, I'd love to. I think it's a very smart, very perfect pairing for it. It's an IPA using Chinook, Citra, and Amarillo hops. Very citrus forward, a little bit of caramel malt in there as well.
Wow.
And so I think a lot of times people will say that spicy foods pair well with IPAs, and I think that's like Chef is demonstrating here, we're talking about these earthier, sort of warmer spices than we are chili spice. So this is
and it works together.
Yeah, thank
and
you.
And did you two get into this business just because you loved beer, or how did you find this path for your career?
Yeah, more or less. I graduated college barely and started looking around, had wonderful supportive parents, and they said, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I really like beer. And who knew? That was a lifetime. So
it's incredible, right?
It's been great.
It's been great ever since.
Yeah.
Amazing. It's so fun. What do you think of the pairing together? You like the two together? Yeah. Worth clapping for.
Okay. Very important when we're dealing with this, just like when you're dealing with making hamburgers or meatballs or anything, is you don't want to work the beef very much.
No.
Minimum working, otherwise it gets tough.
Okay.
So I have this, put all the ingredients together, and I'll just lightly, and keeping the beef cold also is very important.
So when you don't let your hands warm it up too much.
That's right. You want the fat to stay in form. You don't want the fat to melt. That'll make the beef tough.
Yeah. Okay, so here you are thinking you're taking a year off and you're teaching us something amazing. It's just in your blood, isn't it?
Well, you know, the beer, that was...
The beer helps?
That was the cincher. that cinched the deal. So
you're taking a break, but we'll give you great beer.
This beer, by the way, I had to go out and get some beer so I could pair it.
Okay? Yes.
And this beer is wonderful. As you can taste, it has a very, for me as a chef, it has a very hoppy flavor, and it's dry. The ingredients are the same as in a wine, what you're looking for to pair it with food, and that is acid, sugar, certain bitterness. Those things all will either help or fight the pairing. So that bitterness is... from the hops here, it cleanses your palate like right away. So I could use a yogurt for a sauce, and the beef is rich, and the spices, and that beer cuts the spices too. So it's a pairing that I was very happy with.
I love that, and it really does complement it.
Okay, so you make a little like meatball, but an oblong meatball, and you put it right on the skewer.
That makes it a lot easier to cook in that shape as well.
Oh yeah, it does.
Oh, that's great.
Use a little water, and that helps as well.
So you don't burn the skewer, or just to make it come together?
Right, just to make it come together.
And I noticed you've already got your pan smoking hot.
I do. Is it smoking
you want it that hot?
That's good.
You want
Maybe if you pull it off, and I'll put it back on again.
You got it. All right, we'll give it a second while you're finishing those.
Okay,
do we have any oil left? Let's see. You need a little oil for the pan?
Yes, just a tiny bit.
Let's see. So anybody got any oil? Anyone? Anyone? We had our little thing down here. Let's
see. I have enough. There's enough.
Oh, you do?
Oh, yeah.
Great.
We just want to coat
the pan. Oh, yeah. Delightful. We got it. Just enough to render the fat, right? And get it going.
Season it with salt and pepper, of course.
Okay.
You know, in the meat. And then I always like to season it again right before it goes on.
Just like a true chef. You know, I think people, the difference between being a decent cook and a great one is you understand that seasoning makes a huge difference.
It's the little things, isn't it?
Right.
The very, very little things. Salt and pepper, acid of some kind.
Yeah.
A little lemon juice really helps many dishes.
The balance.
It's all about the balance. Okay.
All right.
We're
so here we go.
Coat that pan a little bit.
I love that you're doing this just straight in the cast iron. I'll get this going for you again, since again, this is so, it's smarter than we are, Bob, this cooktop. There it goes. Amazing. Okay. Perfect. So we're going to get it really hot.
What we like to do, what I like to do is grill these, but obviously the atmosphere we're in right now, we couldn't get a grill going, but they're best grilled, but this is also good, second best.
I love that you could just do this at home if you don't feel like grilling.
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
Now, while that's cooking, then we'll do our yogurt sauce.
Okay, great. We need this.
The yogurt sauce is much like a lot of North African food and even Indian food, is when you have these spicy foods, you want something to counteract that spice, and the yogurt is very cooling.
I love that balance.
Yeah. Let's see. Let me get
a... Do you need a spoon? I've got those for you, too.
Okay. Yeah.
So what kind of yogurt do you like? I'm your sous chef.
What I love is goat milk yogurt.
Oh, so we're so lucky where we live, right, that we can access that easily.
Sometimes you have to cultivate a palate for it, but it is really... I have goat milk yogurt at home, and I have kefir too.
It's the tang too, I think. It's got a little more tang to it that I like.
So I've got cucumber in there, and we'll put a little scallion.
Beautiful.
And a little bit of mint.
Okay, more mint. Love it. Morocco on a plate.
That's right.
Oh, and that's so gorgeous.
Simple as that. A little seasoning, of course, a little salt and pepper.
Yep. I moved your knees, sorry. That's going to be so good together. So do you all think a lot about the food you want to eat with the beer that you're making?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, it's a lot like our world, food to wine or beer.
Yeah, I think is that on?
Yeah, I think so. There you go.
No, I think absolutely. Anytime you're beer is food.
Beer is food.
So there's no reason not to have more food with it.
And, right.
Anytime you're having a particular beer, if you're having a pilsner, like a light pilsner that'll really cut through the flavors, it's kind of like a white wine.
Mm.
You know, you want to have that with seafood or with a salad or something like that. But so pilsners are a great cleansing kind of beer. And when you have a nice big IPA like Bob's working with right now, there's where you want to have the flavors and all the spices going on, because it matches the level of flavoring that's in the beer. Yes.
That's right. You don't want to have a delicate Petrali sole with a nice lemon Verblanc.
And then just blow it out with
and
something
blow it
heavy.
Away with a big IPA.
Right. That's right.
Absolutely. Right? You want to say something about it.
I would obviously, that's probably the absolute proper way to think about it. In our film, Sam Cagliano from Dogfish. He even calls beer liquid food. But as a filmmaker, one of the things I was always asking people is, does a beer taste better if you know its story? And everybody says it's not supposed to, because they're brewmasters and it's all about what's in the glass, but it does.
It
absolutely does, and you want to know the story. So for me, the best beer would be what goes best with whatever story you're living at that moment.
That's so nice.
Which is not necessarily the right food choice, but it looks good on camera, I guess. And you know, you associate certain personal experiences with beer. That's what I think I found making the movie, is that people fall in love with beer. Maybe because they had, like, in Vacation, that scene with Chevy and his son, or whatever it is, and they fall in love. And a lot of times it's before you're 21, so it doesn't get talked a lot about because you're not supposed to drink before you're 21. But it's, for me, it's the story of those brewmasters, just like the story of chefs, and therefore the story of the beer.
Which I love that so
and
much.
And beer is ancient. Beer has been with us forever.
Yes, it's been a part of our lives for such a long time.
And what they say, the relationship that beer and wine have is, maybe you've heard it before, but it takes a lot of good beer to make a great wine.
Right. Most of the winemakers are drinking beer along the way. I think it's really true.
Mr. Jim Allen, who is a great friend of mine, who is a winemaker and founder of Sequoia Grove, actually had a keg of beer in his winery at all times.
Those are happy brewmasters, right? Josh, I'm curious too, when you're making beer, are you thinking about the food you would want to pair with it, or are you just doing beer that speaks to you?
At times we are, especially when we're doing smaller and specialty release batches. That's a major consideration, is how do we get this to pair with the food, especially if we're doing some sort of collaborative effort with a local chef and saying, hey, what do you want to see in a beer
that
might pair? So that's a lot of fun for us.
That's amazing. It's just a beautiful, beautiful career, actually. You know, you see this, and I think in the movie, Doug refers to it too, somebody saying it is like being a chef. Like you are cooking something, and there's just so much heart and soul that goes into it. It's going to be really fun to see this film.
Well, thank you. The last thing I would just say is that I learned so much about how beer is a lot like the whole indie film thing. And by the end of it, we were like, the beers are the films, the brewmasters are the directors. There are all these great beer and food festivals now, just like there's something like Napa Valley Film Festival or Sundance.
Yes.
And then there's this huge community that when people are at work, supposed to be thinking about work, they're either thinking about beer or movies. So it's sort of, you know, and then you have the Hollywood movies and the big beers. So it really was this similarity that we felt akin to afterwards.
I love that. Thanks for making the story. It's really great. Does anybody have any questions too? I know he has to go back to his film here quickly, right? He's having to sneak out. Any of you have questions about the beer or the cooking as we go? Before we get to plate up your beautiful dish? Yes.
Are you friends with my mom?
Thank you
for asking that question. Or the producer. I should say your friends.
From Milwaukee,
we just showed it there.
Did you really?
The film is in theaters all over the country now.
Wow.
It actually opened in 7 cities this weekend, but this is
Congratulations.
This place is awesome. That's why I wanted to be here for it.
Yeah.
And on November 20th, it goes on video on demand and all that stuff. And March 5th, it's on Amazon Prime.
Congratulations. That is such a big deal. Wow.
Thank you. Can I take a couple of beers to go?
Yeah.
I hit some. Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you for coming, Doug. We know I can't believe they're showing it at the same time he's supposed to be here, right? Shouldn't we all be doing this together? But we're really lucky that we had you, and he's not kidding. He's taking some of your beer to go. Thank you. You definitely chose the right business, right? So funny. So, Chef, it looks like your dish is ready to come together.
So my couscous is done.
Okay.
What we want to do is just flake it. Better to do with a couple of forks. It's just like rice. The more you move it around, then it starts getting gummy, and you don't want that, of course.
So gently, and it fluffs it up a little bit, gets the lumps out.
It fluffs it up.
Just literally road sodas. I love it. It's a friendly bunch, right?
Smell that.
Oh, so fragrant. Oh, my gosh, it's amazing.
Nice.
And you forget how easy this is.
Yeah,
I couldn't make my carrots look that cute anymore, but I could pull this off.
Okay, so we'll take a little couscous in a pile.
Great. Take the kefta. Oh, wow.
The kefta right there, and then we have...
Gorgeous. And then the yogurt.
The yogurt on top.
Oh, wait, the pretty one. Yeah, I want it with all the goodness in it.
Yes.
Okay. This is just shows you your history and like in a restaurant, just making the simplest things look beautiful as well.
There we go.
That
we
looks
are.
Absolutely gorgeous.
I hope you
gorgeous.
Enjoyed that.
Oh, it's gorgeous. Are you kidding? I'm going to eat it out of the pan. any other questions that you have for us this afternoon? Any beer questions for these two incredibly talented brewmasters? No, any food? I want to know what's next, but you're not going to say yet for you.
The whole beer thing in Napa Valley, people might think there's a conflict there because people are always out here for wine.
Right.
But when I had my restaurant, we had to have good beers on tap and good beers in the cooler because, well, for example, we'd get three couples. They'd come in. They were traveling together, maybe right. a limo up and down the valley.
Yeah.
They'd come in and, the woman wants a Sauvignon Blanc. The next woman wants a Chardonnay. And the next woman, I'll have a Sauvignon Blanc as well. And you go to the men, they go, I want a beer.
I want beer.
I've been tasting wine all day long. Right. I need a beer.
Yeah, you got it. Yeah. And I think, too, just with the film, you see the level of respect that people are starting to understand around beer. It's not an afterthought. I mean, people have loved beer forever. It's to be celebrated.
Well, you know, that's absolutely true. And one of the things I like to say is that, you know, wine is the nectar of the gods. There's no doubt about it. But I like to say that beer is the mother's milk of humanity.
Yeah.
Beer is what has sustained us.
Yes.
That's what keeps us going. And it's done everything from build the pyramids to getting the pilgrims to stop at Plymouth Rock. So there's so many things that beer has been involved with for humanity throughout the ages.
Now I'm always going to picture Egyptians building, drinking beer.
It turns out that was the very first labor dispute recorded in mankind, in the history of mankind. And there was a pharaoh who wanted to build his a pyramid. And he cut back on the beer rations.
Dang.
That stopped the construction right there. There's no doubt about it. It's all in the hieroglyphs. You can read it yourself if
you'd
like.
That's crazy.
So they said no beer, no pyramid.
No
that's
beer,
exactly
no buildings.
Right.
Yeah. Right?
So they got back at it.
That's
got
amazing.
Their beer, they got back at it.
I love it. Well, this is such an enjoyable
question
way to kick
there?
Off. Is there
question?
A question? Oh, yeah, right here.
Beer, especially in the United States, is so hoppy forward.
Josh, first.
Are you asking Elysian specific, or I mean, sure.
Why not?
I'll take that time, I guess. We do a number of beers, mostly year rounds that we tend to feature because of the availability. So Dragon's Tooth Stout, a larger imperial stout, higher in alcohol, high in roast and chocolate malts. That's a good one. People often use that with desserts and things because of the sweetness, but it can certainly be used to braise meats and things like that. So that's. That's one of the other benefits that we don't actually filter any of our beers, so there's always a little bit of yeast, and owing to that and the acidity of beer, it's a good, I find it to be a good liquid for doing some braising stuff. And
oh, that's great. For braising, I love. People forget that you can braise with other things besides wine. I love beer, I love tequila, actually, like darker tequilas, so amazing. What about you? Any beers that...
That's really interesting, because the whole idea of putting hops into beer, especially at the level that we're doing it nowadays, mm-hmm. is brand new.
Oh.
And when we first started making even craft beer, mm-hmm. it was always a little bit more malt forward and not with the amount of hops in it.
Right.
So hops make it a little more difficult to pair with food. There's no doubt about it. If you have a malty beer like a big amber ale with a lot of malt flavors, that goes delicious with any kind of umami kind of characters or flavors. And pilsners, like I was saying before, a pilsner goes great with a light salad or with a fish. But then you get into an IPA, which is very popular these days, India pale ales with lots and lots of hops. It makes the beer drinking experience awesome because you get all those really interesting flowery flavors, but it does make it more difficult to pair with foods. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't like the big bitterness in an IPA, so they go back to a pale ale or an amber ale or a pilsner or something like that. So the hops that are so popular today, and especially West Coast beers as opposed to East Coast beers, East Coasts mm-hmm. Really accentuate more of the malt flavors. Personally, I like a little bit more malt flavor than a big, huge IPA.
Right.
Although I appreciate a great IPA, too.
You can appreciate all of it, right? Different varietals, almost.
Free beer is the best beer.
That's amazing. That's what we love about beer drinkers, I think is what you just said, which is so nice. It's so it's so approachable. One more question.
So, forgive me if this is a New York question, but I made
not couscous.
No, this is also wheat derived. It comes from semolina, and when you buy, you can make the couscous yourself, and you would start with semolina flour and with some liquid, and but you have to roll it, and it's a time consuming, kind of complicated process. Not really complicated, but more time consuming.
Right.
So we always get it from the package because it's still very, very good.
And when you see Israeli, it's just a lot larger grain than it is.
Yeah,
and it's you'll see it. And it always says Israeli on the packaging. So just like regular couscous, right. I say comes in this
But it
shape.
Is wheat. It's definitely wheat. Yeah.
Definitely wheat. Yeah. One more question. Cows, beer. We have to explain that you truly do raise the cattle.
That's right.
And you feed them the grains that you've used to make your beer.
That's right. Beer is made out of four ingredients. It's amazing that you can have as many flavors as you do in different beers. Malted barley, water, hops, and yeast. Malted barley,
water again, huge theme today.
Hops and yeast, yes. Yeah. And so those are the main ingredients. After the brewer has extracted everything he wants from the malted barley, then what he's left with is what are called spent grains. The spent grains are just pure barley, and that barley then I collect after the brewing process, and I put it in big bins, and I take it up to the ranch. And I drive through the gate of the ranch, and then I hear this
here he is with our breakfast.
Here's the food truck, and it just is literally a stampede because they love their spent grains. There's a little bit of starch left in it. There's a lot of protein and a lot of minerals left in it. And so it's fantastic for beef cattle. It's probably even better for milk cows.
Wow.
So milk cows produce more milk when they're eating their spent grains.
Now,
and
these
affects
grains
the
are
flavor.
They're not fermented at this point at all, right?
There's no fermentation at all at this point in time. It's just the malted barley that's been infused with hot water. That hot water's been extracted out of it for the brewing process to make the beer. And what's left over are the spent grains. And so those come home, and they keep the cows nice and plump. The cows that we're raising are still all grass-fed. They're on the field,
wow.
But just a little bit.
Just they get a little extra something.
They get a little something extra when it's this time of year and all that grass is really dry and there's not much food left in it. They love their
happy
spent
California
grains.
Cows.
They
yeah,
are,
it's happy
right?
cows.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's just I love that's the story between the two of you too, that you've known each other so long through this, and I just feel incredibly lucky to have all of this talent with us here to wrap up the afternoon, and so. Let's see if I can thank everyone who was a part of this. And first of all, to encourage you, because Napa Valley Brewery Showcase is serving back here today. So as you leave, if you want to try some, I say yes, if you want to try some other beers in addition to the Hangar 1 and the Glenfiddich Dome back there, which is incredible, and everything we have from Wanderlux over here to try as well. They've been incredible sponsors. But Whole Foods Minor Family Winery has just shown up all over this festival all weekend. We're so grateful. And for Cuisinart and for Monogram as well. And most importantly, all three of you, thank you for spending your time and sharing your knowledge with us. And thank you all for being here. It was a wonderful time.
I've got to do a shout out to Monogram because their equipment here, being a professional chef,
it's incredible.
There's nothing worse than working on equipment that's not
Doesn't work.
Up to speed. And this stuff is all highly professional stuff, and it's a pleasure to work on it. I don't know if Monogram is here, but
they have been here,
that's
and then
great.
Their ovens have been incredible as well. So top of the line, everything for us to cook on this weekend. It was such a pleasure. So I hope you enjoy the rest of the festival and your time here with us. Thank you so much. Feel free to come say hi. Thank you. I have to eat one of these.
Oh, yeah.
I can't have gluten.